the wall. Anybody? Did anyone know that there was a difference? No.
Well, I'd imagine hitting the walls, yeah.
Hitting the wall means fatigue. Bonking is when you don't have enough nutrition.
Your core.
Yeah, when you push your body too hard.
Muscle
wise.
Yeah, right. So the difference is muscle versus brain. Typically. So hitting the wall is more the muscle fatigue. So, like, I guess I should ask also, who's hit the wall before? Anybody? Okay, what does it feel like?
It's horrible.
Horrible? It's like what?
Can't go on.
Can't go on.
You feel like you can't go on. You have to just pouch it.
Yeah. You just want to stop and walk.
Yeah.
So one of my favorite descriptions I've heard so far is like your legs feel like cement.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, hard to pick up.
You can't move, that kind of thing. So that's more of the descriptions of hitting the wall. And what that is hitting the wall is related to our carbohydrate stores in our muscle. Bonking is related to our carbohydrate stores in our liver. The three main places that we have carbohydrate stores are our muscles, our liver, and our blood. Okay. Our blood, obviously, we use extremely quickly unless we have some kind of issue, like diabetes or something like that. Our liver is also a very quick source, typically, of carbohydrate. It is a good storage spot still, also. And then our muscle is very important. So, just a stat that I think is kind of cool is the average 150-pound male has 1,800 calories of carbohydrate stored in their muscle, liver, and blood. So, if by math, just alone, if we're running 100 calories per mile, right? We have 1,800 calories stored. We could run how many miles?
1,800.
18, without doing anything. And people do that. I would not recommend it, because you're depleting everything. You're likely going to hit the wall. But that is just for reference.
It's a great point for most of those folks we run with. That's why we take you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's really good.
Okay, so now with hitting the wall, some cool things are that our trained muscle is much better at storing carbohydrate than an untrained muscle. 20 to 50% better at storing carbohydrate. Okay, so that's pretty cool. It makes it better and easier to use our carbohydrate. With that, how many people, when they're training for a marathon or half marathon, have you or have you heard someone complain about gaining weight? Yeah. Most people do, men less likely than women, but a lot of people do gain weight when they run a half or a full marathon or anything distance. So now think about it. Our muscle is getting better at storing carbs. We're gaining weight. With every ounce of carbohydrate we eat, we store 3 ounces of water. Yeah, we're gonna gain weight. Okay, so keep that in mind. There are people, yes, that do lose weight, but for a lot of people, they do gain while training. So I wouldn't recommend running a marathon. It's a way to lose weight. You can do it, but it's not the best thing for you. Okay, so that's a side note. So in order to avoid hitting the wall, we want to have our well-trained muscles that keep the carbohydrate stores high. We want to carb load daily. We don't want to not have carbs on days we don't train, or vice versa. We want to make sure that we get our carbs in. Rule of thumb, again, is 3 to 5 grams per day. Or, sorry, per pound per day. Okay, does that make sense? What that averages out to be is about 45 to 65% of your calories should be from carbohydrate. Okay. A couple things to help with hitting the wall is tapering training. So I know all of our programs here, we taper about 2 weeks out. So with that, what happens nutritionally as we're tapering? Any thoughts?
We still eat the same amount.
Still eat the same amount or more. We're not breaking down the stores in our muscle, so we're storing even more. Our muscles are trained, so we're storing all of those carbs better so that we don't hit the wall.
Does that mean we utilize them better as well then?
You have more stored, so I wouldn't say there's a difference in utilization.
Okay.
But the store is there and easier to use than when you're constantly depleting it.
Okay.
And I don't think utilization changes a whole lot. Don't quote me on that.
Well, that'd be metabolism, right? The way we utilize things. And I mean, we can train our bodies to do better by doing this kind of stuff.
Right.
Yeah.
So again, also when tapering, you're probably going to gain even more weight, anywhere from 2 to 4 pounds, because we're not burning those carbs, we're storing them, and we're storing them more efficiently. So some other things, just obviously general rules of healthy eating as far as hitting the wall, is making sure you get enough protein. Most of us do, it's not an issue. Avoiding fat loading. A lot of people think, oh well, I'm gonna eat a cheesecake, you know, for dinner to keep my weight up or whatever. Not the best thing to do. Pretty much what I recommend is moderation. You know, some people will say, well, you know, I need a carb load, I'm gonna eat all fruit for like 3 days. Yeah, you're gonna be running to the bathroom.
Yeah.
That's not a good idea. So try to moderate, you know, nothing crazy off the wall. Get some fiber. Fluids are important. We want to be nice and hydrated before a big event. And yeah, that's pretty much it. Any questions about hitting the wall? Does that make sense? Okay. So we'll talk about bonking. So that's when our liver stores get low. Our body tends to use both typically equally, but obviously it depends on your personal body, whether you would hit the wall or just bonk. Everyone's different, your situation is different, how fast you're going, that all affects it. So symptoms of bonking is more of that mental stuff that I was talking about, so like losing coordination, feeling lightheaded, you know, you can't concentrate, you can't think about anything. That's more of the bonking. So bonking, or liver stores, are more of an immediate store. So I would recommend, if that's something that happens to you more commonly, is watch what you have that day and 24 hours prior to. You know what I'm talking about? Okay. So, for example, you're nervous for your run, right? You have a big marathon coming up or whatever it might be. You probably don't sleep very well. You probably are nervous the morning of the race. Don't really feel like eating. So the combination of not resting, so we're burning more calories, and on top of that, being nervous, we have to be extra careful about what we eat. So I always recommend something like a liquid, so like orange juice or milk, or anything that you can tolerate that morning, getting enough in, as well as if you're up at 2 o'clock in the morning already because you're nervous, eat something. You need it. Any questions about any of that? Yeah.
I don't know what this is. Before I started using the boom and stuff like that, I would kind of get nauseous in the middle of a long run. Is that a symptom of any of that? I mean, I would, instead of feeling, I mean, I guess I would feel weak, but I feel like I wanted to puke.
Not necessarily.
Okay.
I would attribute it more to like nerves or to adrenaline rush or something like that, but I don't know. It would really depend.
Okay.
Yeah.
Does carbo loading come into play?
Yes.
Myth or not?
So when you think of carb loading, what do you think of?
I think that I hear people every weekend on a Friday night say, oh yeah, we're going out to dinner, we got a big run tomorrow, I'm going to go get a ton of pasta.
Okay. So that's the traditional old school way of carb loading.
Yes.
The night before, we're going to eat 5 plates of spaghetti and we're ready to go. After eating 5 plates of spaghetti, I wouldn't feel very good.
No.
Most people shouldn't feel very good. So what we typically recommend, and I can go more into detail later, but basically carb loading and increasing your carbs throughout those 2 weeks of tapering. So slowly increase, not just a one night thing the day before.
So you definitely will gain weight then, because you're storing that stuff better and you're eating more every day, a little bit more every day.
Yeah.
While we're on the topic of tapering, I was wondering what you thought about supercompensation. Maybe that's not like the common term for it, but like instead of, it's like a different type of taper where you like on the first day of the week you train really, really hard to deplete your muscle glycogen stores, and then you don't eat carbohydrates for 2 days, and then so your body is completely depleted in carbs, and then you start retaking your carbs in a few days before the race. I guess it's been sort of shown to work better, possibly, but there are a lot of doubts. I don't know, there's a lot of downsides to it too.
Yeah, the research I've read has not supported that.
Okay. We've had people try that around here, and it's not been very good for them.
Yeah.
So, and that might be recreational runners who are trying to do this because they read it online or whatever.
Yeah.
So maybe if you're a sport-specific athlete and you're somebody who's going to the Olympics and you've had a nutritionist your whole life, maybe they can do that. But the average Joe, to deplete them out of what they're normally eating to go into something like that has not proven. For the five or six people I know who have done it, it's been extremely bad. Right, so, and then we're talking general public.
Can you explain the concept again? I couldn't hear.
So, basically, depleting yourself and your stores for a few days and then ramping up within that week, for example. So, like, Monday through Wednesday, not having any carbs, training really hard, depleting all your stores, and then bouncing back and eating all those carbs. And in theory, overstoring, since your body hasn't had any, so you're better, more efficient. If your body really doesn't work that way.
We've got the book downstairs, Performance Nutrition for Runners. It has a really good last 24-hour carb loading regimen that makes a lot of sense to me.
Yeah.
Essentially eating small meals every couple hours and doing things like drinking and sugar that have lots of carbs in them. So you never feel full in that whole 24 hours. You know, it's not like you're taking this massive amount of food at any one time.
Right.
But you're still getting a ton of carbs in that period. And so you arrive at the starting line loaded, but feeling light, and your digestive system is ready to go. You know, you're not all like, I ate too much last night.
Right. Yeah, and that's where liquid carbs are good for running. Typically, in the general population, I really highly advise against liquid carbohydrates just because it's really fast and really easy, a good way to get empty calories for the most part. But as you're training for a long run, liquid carbs are gonna be your friend. So definitely, that will definitely help replace what you have or what you need. Speaking of resources, I have two books that unfortunately we don't have here. That are really good. I can pass them around if you guys have questions. This one's a little bit more like user friendly. It's got pictures and it actually even has like a urine chart so you can check, you know, if you're hydrated or not. And this one's far more textbook.
What are they called?
This is Nancy Clark's Food Guide for Marathoners. If you have anyone who wants to know anything about running and food, Nancy Clark is your lady. She is she's been around for a long time. She knows what she's doing. She's a dietitian and a marathoner herself, so I think she is a great resource. This book goes into a lot more depth with all of the science. So if you want to know specific research studies, stuff about like what you're talking about, it's in here. It's also in here a little bit, but again, it's got pictures and stuff. So if you guys want to